Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Everyday People, Extraordinary Leadership. How to make a difference, regardless of your title, role, or authority. By James M. Kouzes and Barry Z. Posner. Narrated by Sean Pratt. Publisher's Note. This audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface. The premise and the promise. The premise of Everyday People, Extraordinary Leadership, How to Make a Difference Regardless of Your Title, Role, or Authority, is quite simple. Leadership is a learnable set of actions and behaviors that is available to everyone. In this book, we make the case that leadership is not about rank, position, or authority, and we will provide data to support this claim. We'll also share examples of individuals who, as a result of engaging in practices of exemplary leadership, have guided others in making extraordinary things happen in their organizations and communities. Everyday People, Extraordinary Leadership is about what individuals do to affect change and improvement. It's about the behaviors and actions individuals use to transform values into actions, visions into realities, obstacles into innovations, division into unity, and risks into rewards. It's about exercising leadership that contributes to creating an environment in which people can work together to turn perplexing problems and challenging opportunities into remarkable successes. All too often, when leadership is discussed within workplaces and communities, attention is given primarily to those appointed or elected to positions of authority. While leaders with titles certainly deserve credit for what they do, they are not the only people who matter. In fact, we would argue that there are just as many, probably even more, leaders without titles who contribute to collective achievements and well-being. Workplace and community engagement are not just a function of what formal leaders do. They are also related to how all leaders in organizations behave. The COVID-19 pandemic is a case in point as it spread across the globe, overwhelming healthcare systems, shutting down a significant number of commerce and educational systems, and totally disrupting the normal way of life for effectively every person on the planet. It has been an unprecedented crisis like no other experienced in our lifetime. While there are, and have to be, global, national, regional, state, and local coordinated efforts to address the pandemic, it is also the many small acts of leadership among doctors, nurses, first responders, teachers, parents, students, volunteers, and other concerned citizens that make a difference. They create novel ways to treat the sick, care for the vulnerable, deal with shortages, produce personal protective equipment, recognize heroes, and even bring a bit of joy to an otherwise tragic and depressing situation. Another case in point about how tragedy and adversity create opportunities for people to step up and lead, and that leadership arises as much, if not more so, from the bottom up as it does from the top down, is the response to the death of George Floyd while in police custody. His death was the tipping point in long-standing tensions around matters of racial and social justice and police treatment of people of color. Within a day of the event, protests began, first in Minneapolis, where the incident occurred, and then across the United States and in major cities around the world. These were mostly decentralized actions, initiated largely by young people of highly diverse backgrounds, who had no formal titles or positions. They captured the attention of governments, businesses, and ordinary citizens, and supercharged calls for more diversity, equity, and inclusion in every institution. There continues to be no shortage of challenges facing individuals, organizations, and communities, and no limits to the opportunities and needs for people to lead. We wrote this book to help you prepare to become the best leader you can be and take advantage of the chances you have to make this world a little bit better place than you find it. who should listen to this book. This book is for and about people who do not have titles, like supervisor, manager, executive, chief, head, director, captain, boss, and the like, or some formal authority over other people. It's intended for frontline workers, new hires, individual contributors, salespeople, analysts, researchers, consultants, professionals, community activists, volunteers, project leads, scientists, engineers, administrators, artists, athletes, attorneys, programmers, coaches, teachers, parents, and all the others who lead without the benefit of hierarchical position or rank. The book aims to help people, no matter their role, strengthen their capacity to make extraordinary things happen. We also wrote this book to uplift your spirits. We will show you how you can be effective at leading without any formal authority. Leadership matters from wherever you do it. We have learned from our research, which is discussed in each chapter, that people who aren't managers or executives are far more capable of developing themselves as leaders and exercising leadership than tradition or myth has ever assumed possible. Managers, executives, and leadership developers will benefit as well from listening to this book. They will find here example after example of people who have made extraordinary things happen without having the advantage of title or positional power. We hope that it will reinforce the need for them to provide leadership development opportunities to everyone in their organization, and much sooner in people's careers than they typically do. We know that the best leaders are the best learners, and learning leadership is begun before people join the workforce or take on formal or official organizational responsibilities. As you will hear from the scores of examples in this book, the principles apply regardless of the nature of your organization, and they are not dependent upon any particular demographic characteristic, for example, age, gender, ethnicity, function, nationality, etc., or personality variable. The focus is on the behaviors and actions of what people do when they are exercising exemplary leadership. Research-based practices. The principles and practices described in Everyday People, Extraordinary Leadership are based solidly on quantitative and qualitative research. The book has its origins in a study we began in 1983. We wanted to know what people did when they were at their personal best in leading others. People see their individual leadership standards of excellence in these experiences. We started with the assumption that to discover best practices, we didn't have to interview and survey star performers, select celebrities, or people at the top. Instead, we assumed that by asking people at all levels and across a broad array of organizational settings to describe extraordinary experiences, we would be able to find and identify patterns of success. And we did. The results of our initial investigation and of the ongoing research we have conducted for nearly four decades have been striking in their consistency and are a refutation of many leader stereotypes. People frequently assume, for example, that leadership is different from one type of organization or culture to the next. Nothing could be further from the truth. While each setting may look different from the outside, we find that what leaders do when they are at their best is quite similar. This pattern of behavior varies little across locations and circumstances. It's true enough that the context keeps evolving, and the landscape of workplaces, communities, and countries has shifted over time, but leadership remains an understandable and generalizable process. While each leader is a unique individual, there are shared patterns to the practice of leadership. In each chapter of this book, you will find empirical evidence that shows the positive difference leaders without titles make across a wide spectrum of settings. You can find out more about how we conducted the research for this book in the appendix. Details about the research methodology, including the psychometric properties of the leadership practices inventory and analytics, as well as highlights of validation studies by various independent scholars, are available on our website, www.leadershipchallenge.com. Those interested in broadening their perspective on leadership should look at some of our other leadership books, such as Credibility: How Leaders Gain and Lose It, Why People Demand It. The Truth About Leadership: The No-Fads, Heart of the Matter Facts You Need to Know. And Learning Leadership: The Five Fundamentals of Becoming an Exemplary Leader. A Guidebook on Leadership. Consider Everyday People, Extraordinary Leadership as a guidebook to take along on your leadership journey. We have designed it to describe what leaders do, explain the fundamental principles that support these leadership practices, and provide actual case examples of real people in the workplace or community who demonstrate each practice. Based on the real-world experiences of thousands of people who have answered the call for leadership, we offer specific recommendations on what you can do to make these practices your own and to continue your leadership development. Chapter 1 introduces you to our point of view about leadership, specifically, that leadership is not a position, hierarchical place, or genetic trait. We discuss leadership as a relationship and reveal who is at the top of the list of leadership role models. We describe the characteristics that people most desire in their leaders and present the foundation on which all great leadership is built. We briefly describe the five practices of exemplary leadership revealed in our research. We tell the leadership story from the inside and move outward, describing leadership first as a personal journey of exploration and then as a mobilization of others. The research shows that leadership is not the private reserve of a few charismatic men and women, but instead a learnable set of behaviors and actions people use when they are bringing forth the best from themselves and others. In chapters 2 through 6, we explore each of the five practices, one to a chapter, and demonstrate that taken together, they provide an operating system for leadership. Once you understand the operating system, you can create and run any number of different applications off of it, akin to what an operating system provides for computer software. Discussions build on the results of our original research, buttressed by studies from other scholars, and provide a particular point of view on leadership that is empirically sound and practically useful. Case examples and empirical evidence generously illustrate each leadership practice and document how using more of each practice yields more favorable outcomes. Each chapter has recommended actions, concluding with two specific first steps that you should take to put the leadership practice to use in developing your leadership capabilities. In Chapter 7, we share some concluding research on how leadership matters not only to your colleagues or community, but also to you personally. We discuss six fundamentals for learning leadership and explore three basic types of learning opportunities. In so doing, we aim to demystify leadership, and show how every person has the capacity to learn to lead. Finally, we advise that the best process of becoming the best leader you can be will fundamentally change who you are and how you present yourself day in and day out. To that end, we offer a concluding reflective activity to help you get started on the next stage of your leadership journey. The Future of Leadership. The domain of leaders is the future. We hope this book contributes to the ongoing revitalization of the workplace and the renewal of healthy communities and to greater respect and understanding among people of all traditions. We fervently hope that it enriches your life and the lives of your colleagues, your friends, and family. The most significant contribution you can make as a leader is to strengthen others so they can adapt, grow, and flourish. Leadership matters. It's essential in every sector, in every community, and in every country. In these times of unprecedented change, organizations and communities need more leaders, and now more than ever they need leaders who can unite and mobilize others in a common cause. So much extraordinary work needs to be done, and you have the opportunity to make a meaningful difference in how it is done. Accept the challenge to learn to become the best leader you can be, for the sake of your community, your workplace, and for those you love. James M. Kouzes, Barry Z. Posner, November 2020. Chapter 1. Leadership is not a position. When you hear the word leader, what immediately comes to mind? Maybe you think of someone with a title, such as CEO, President, Prime Minister, or Admiral. Maybe you think of some famous public figure, such as a celebrity actor or singer, startup founder, or pro athlete. Maybe you think of someone from the history books who led a revolution, conquest, or world-changing movement. Or maybe you think of someone who created a breakthrough invention, won the Nobel or Pulitzer Prize, wrote a best-selling novel, or Grammy-winning song. It's rather common to see these kinds of responses. They are reinforced every time you read one of those lists of the 50 greatest leaders of the year. In fact, if you take a look at one of the most well-known lists, you'll see that 100% of the so-called greatest leaders fall into these categories. It's true for young leaders as well. In a list of young global leaders prepared by the World Economic Forum, 85% of the young leaders held the title of a senior executive, founder, or government official. The majority of leaders who make these lists and are featured in the popular press are people with titles and at the apex of their organizations. It's not that these individuals aren't leaders. They are. It's just that they are not the only leaders on the planet. In fact, they aren't even the majority of leaders. We've collected data from millions of people around the world, and we can report, without a doubt, that there are leaders everywhere. There are leaders in every profession, discipline, and field, in every type of organization and industry, every religion, and every country. You find them from young to old, male, female, and gender non-conforming, across every ethnic and cultural category. Leaders are not just found at the top of organizations. They abound at all levels, including the middle, as well as on the front lines. There are leaders outside of formal organizations, too, in neighborhoods, community associations, clubs, sports teams, and families. You could have a title, like manager, director, or vice president. You could have people who report to you directly, but these would not necessarily make you a leader. Titles are granted, but being a leader is something that you earn, and you earn it not by your place in the organization, but by how you behave. And through your behavior, you earn recognition as a leader in the eyes of those around you, and in the relationships you have with them. Indeed, it's much more likely that you are a leader who is a parent, coach, teacher, frontline worker, project manager, volunteer, community activist, or concerned citizen. You could also be a leader who is an individual contributor, professional, volunteer, analyst, consultant, representative, administrator, engineer, or scientist. You don't have to be at the top to lead. You can lead from any position or place. So let's get something straight right from the start. Leadership is not a hierarchical level. It is not a title or rank. It is not a position of power or a place of privilege. When you look up the word leadership in the dictionary, it does not start with an uppercase L. It starts with a lowercase L. And lead, leader, and leadership literally derive from the word meaning to go or to guide. That's what leadership is all about. going places, and guiding others. From whom do people seek this kind of guidance and direction? We decided to find out. Leadership is a relationship. In a global study involving over 35,000 people, we asked them to think about the individuals in their lives who were their role models for leadership. We provided a number of categories from which their leadership role model might come. Take a look at the list in Table 1.1. From which category is the one person whom you would choose as your leadership role model? Whom did you select? When thinking back over their lives and selecting their most important leadership role models, respondents overwhelmingly nominated a family member more often than anyone else. Next most important were a teacher or coach or an immediate supervisor. Those under 25 years of age, Generation Z, had these ranked second and third, while millennials, Generation Y and Generation X, ages 25 to 55, and boomers, 56 and older, had them ranked in the reverse order. For those in the workplace, their teachers and coaches are their immediate supervisors. Another 6% indicated a coworker or colleague. Altogether, these four categories accounted for more than 3/4 of all responses. 8% indicated none and or not sure, which meant that only 16% of all responses were in the categories of business leader, community leader, political leader, religious leader, actor or entertainer, and professional athlete. This pattern is relatively stable across genders, ethnic groups, educational levels, industries, professions, and even hierarchical levels. The data clearly shows that the people selected are individuals respondents are closest to. They are not the people in the news, on TV, or in social media. They're the ones with whom people have had the most frequent contact. In other words, leadership role models are local. While famous folks may occupy the headlines, those with whom you have more personal contact are most likely to become your role models and have more influence over how you lead and how you develop as a leader. And make no mistake about it, the same realization applies to you. You very well could be the leadership role model for those closest to you, more than could someone on that so-called list of the world's best leaders. These results have extremely important implications. Parents, teachers, and coaches are the individuals who are setting the leadership example for young people. It's not hip-hop artists, movie stars, professional athletes, or others making news on social media who inspire them about leadership. And if you are a parent, a teacher, or volunteer coach, you are the one they are most likely going to look to for the example of how a leader responds to competitive situations, handles crises, deals with loss, or resolves ethical dilemmas. It's not someone else. It's you. The findings also reveal that if you're in a work organization, you are more likely to find role models among your colleagues on your immediate team than at the pinnacle of the organization or somewhere on the outside. If you are now a supervisor or manager, you may already be someone's role model. You are more likely than any other person in the organization to influence their desire to stay or leave, the trajectory of their careers, their ethical behavior, their ability to perform at their best, their drive to wow customers, and their motivation to share and serve the organization's vision and values. There's no escape. To some, you are or could be their role model for leading. Those individuals could be colleagues on your team. They could be peers in another part of your workplace. They could be kids on the youth athletic team or club you coach after work. They could be people from your community who are working with you as a volunteer, or it could be your son or daughter, spouse or partner at home. A question for you to consider. If you are potentially a role model for someone, wouldn't you want to be the best role model you can be? It's your choice. Just be aware that regardless of title or position, be it at home, in school, the community, or workplace, you must take responsibility for the quality of leadership the people around you observe and receive. You are accountable to yourself and others for the leadership you demonstrate. The individuals selected most frequently as leadership role models, family members, teachers, coaches, immediate supervisors, and coworkers, also make evident the most important finding of all. They underscore the truth that leadership is a relationship. Leadership is a relationship between those who aspire to lead and those who choose to follow. This is true regardless of whether the relationship is one-to-one or one-to-many. If you are going to be a leader whose guidance others want to follow willingly, there must be a human connection, something that binds you and others together. It's the quality of this relationship that will determine, over the long term, whether others will follow your lead or not. To lead effectively, you have to appreciate the underlying dynamics of the leader-constituent relationship. It's extremely important to understand, therefore, the qualities that people look for in the leaders they would willingly follow. If people are going to want to follow you over the course of a project or the course of a career, what do they most want to see in your behavior? A relationship between people characterized by fear and distrust will never produce anything of lasting value. A relationship characterized by mutual respect and confidence will overcome the greatest adversities and leave a legacy of significance. Any discussion of leadership must attend to the dynamics of this relationship. Strategies, tactics, skills, and techniques are empty without an understanding of the essential human aspirations that connect people with their leaders and leaders with their people. Credibility is the foundation of leadership. What sort of person would you listen to, take advice from, be influenced by, and willingly follow, not because you have to, but because you want to? What does it take for you to be the kind of person that others want to follow, doing so enthusiastically and voluntarily? Understanding and responding to these expectations is essential to the exercise of exemplary leadership. To understand this leader-constituent relationship, we have routinely been conducting surveys over the past 40 years about the personal values, traits, and characteristics that people indicate are most important to them in an individual they would willingly follow. A key word in this sentence is willingly. It is one thing to follow someone because you think you have to, or else, and it's another when you follow an individual because you want to. We've gathered responses from more than 120,000 respondents, and they have been striking in their consistency over the years. Our evidence shows that people must pass several essential character tests before they earn the designation of leader from other people, as demonstrated by the data presented in Table 1.2. All the characteristics receive votes, and therefore each one is important to at least some individuals. What is most evident, however, is that over time, across continents, demographic, and organizational differences, only four have continuously received the majority, over 60%, of the preferences. What people most look for and admire in a leader has been constant. If people are going to follow someone willingly, they must believe the individual is honest, competent, inspiring, and forward-looking. While the fact that what people look for in their leaders has remained consistent over time, despite the ever-shifting forces affecting economic and social life, there is another profound implication revealed by this data. These survey results have a solid conceptual foundation in what social psychologists and communications experts refer to as source credibility. In assessing the believability of sources of information, whether newscasters, Salespeople, physicians, or priests, whether business executives, military officers, politicians, or civic leaders. Researchers typically evaluate them on their perceived trustworthiness, expertise, and dynamism. The more highly people are rated on these three dimensions, the more credible they are perceived as sources of information. Notice how remarkably similar these three characteristics are to the essential qualities people want from their leaders. Honest, competent, and inspiring. Three of the top four items selected in our surveys. Link the theory to this data, and the striking conclusion is that people want to follow leaders who, more than anything, are credible. Credibility is the foundation of leadership. People must be able, above all else, to believe in their leaders. To willingly follow them, people must believe that the leader's word can be trusted, that they are personally passionate and enthusiastic about the work, and that they have the knowledge and skill to lead. If you are going to ask others to follow you to some uncertain future, and if the journey is going to require hardships and possibly sacrifices, then it's imperative that people believe in you. People must be able to believe that your words can be trusted, that you will do what you say, that you are personally excited and enthusiastic about the direction in which the group is headed, and that you have the knowledge and skills to lead. This all leads to the first law of leadership. If people don't believe in the messenger, they won't believe the message. The five practices of exemplary leadership. So, what is it that leaders do to build and sustain credibility? What do they do that makes others see them as capable and trustworthy leaders? What are the behaviors that people exhibit that engage and mobilize others to want to follow? What are people actually doing when they are leading and making extraordinary things happen? To answer these questions, we have been asking people since the early 1980s to tell us what they did when they were at their personal best as leaders. We continue to ask this question in our studies and workshops around the world. We have collected thousands of personal best leadership experiences, stories about times when individuals report how they excelled at leading, when they were operating at peak performance, from across a wide variety of settings, nationalities, organizations, levels, ages, genders, educational backgrounds, and the like. We've interviewed students in universities, individual contributors at work, middle managers in large and small companies, volunteers in the community, and executives in the C-suite about times when they excelled at leading, when they were doing their best as leaders. Before finding out what others said, reflect for a moment on something that you would consider your personal best leadership experience. This experience could be a time when you emerged as the informal leader, or it could be a time when you were appointed to take on the lead role in a new project. It could be in any functional area, in any type of organization, in a staff or line role. The experience does not need to be in your current organization. It could be in a prior job, a club, a community volunteer setting, a professional organization, a school, a team, a congregation, or even a family setting. It could be a project to improve a product or service, an initiative to bring about a change in your neighborhood, the turnaround of a poorly performing team, the startup of a new business, jumping in during a crisis, or any other kind of challenge that required leadership. When we initially analyzed the themes in the thousands of personal best stories we had collected, two meta-lessons emerged and continued to be front and center. The first lesson we learned is that everyone has a story to tell. Regardless of whom we ask, people are able to identify a time when they did their best as a leader. The specifics of the personal best stories varied from person to person because the individuals responding to the personal best leadership experience questionnaire were different from one another along a myriad of factors. despite any individual differences, settings, and circumstances. The second lesson we learned is that the actions and behaviors of leaders when at their personal best are more similar than they are different. There is a set of common behaviors and actions that people demonstrate when they operate at their personal best as leaders. These behaviors are universal, and they have stood the test of time and place. Moreover, hundreds of independent scholars have validated this framework in their own studies, investigating the central role leadership plays in personal well-being, organizational productivity, and effectiveness. The evidence is clear. Exemplary leadership is found in every corner of the globe, every sector of society, every community, every organization, and every type of individual. We've grouped these behaviors into a leadership operating system that we call the 5 Practices of Exemplary Leadership. When making extraordinary things happen, leaders model the way, inspire a shared vision, challenge the process, enable others to act, encourage the heart. Let's take a brief look now at each of the 5 practices. We will explore them more completely in chapters 2-6. In those chapters, you will find numerous stories and examples about how people much like you have applied them in their settings. We'll also provide several practical ideas about how you can learn to be the best leader you can be. Model the way. Titles are granted, but it's your behavior that earns you respect. This sentiment was expressed in everyone's personal best case, as represented by such comments as, "I couldn't tell anyone what to do, I had to show them. I had to be a role model for the behavior I wanted from others." And, "I had to be clear about my personal values and then make sure that I walked the talk." Exemplary leaders know that if they want to earn the respect of the people around them and achieve the highest standards, they must be models of the behavior they expect of others. Exemplary leaders model the way. To effectively model the way, you first must be clear about your guiding principles. You must clarify values by finding your voice. When you understand who you are and the values you hold dear, then you can speak authentically about the beliefs that you want to guide your decisions and actions. But your values aren't the only values that matter. Leaders don't speak just for themselves. They also speak for the group. And in every team, organization, and community, there are others who also feel strongly about matters of principle. As a leader, you also must help identify and affirm the shared values of the group you are working with. Without an agreed-on and collective understanding of what is right and what is wrong, then anything goes, and there are neither practical nor ethical standards for people to follow. When it comes to determining how serious leaders are about what they say, however, a leader's actions are far more important than their words. People listen to the talk, and then they watch the walk. Words and actions must be consistent for leaders to be believed, so exemplary leaders set the example by aligning actions with shared values. The best way that you prove that something is important is by doing it yourself. Through daily actions, leaders demonstrate their deep commitment to their beliefs and to the shared values of the groups they are part of. Inspire a shared vision. People describe their personal best leadership experiences as times when they imagined exciting and meaningful futures for themselves and others. They reported actions such as, "I told the team that we need everyone's commitment to make our vision a reality, to reach our dreams and make them happen. The more I imagined what was possible, the more clearly I could describe what the future might hold in store for all of us. And we had to be aligned so that we could find a common purpose as a team going forward." They had a desire to create something that no one else had ever created before. They had visions of what could be, and they had absolute faith and confidence that those aspirations could become reality. When performing at their best, leaders inspire a shared vision. In many ways, leaders live their lives backward. By building upon experiences, they see pictures in their mind's eye of what success will look like even before they've started their projects, much as architects draw blueprints or engineers build models. Their clear image of the future pulls them forward, and they are able to speak enthusiastically and energetically about the compelling possibilities. They envision the future by imagining exciting and ennobling possibilities. Yet visions seen only by leaders are insufficient to create an organized movement or a significant change. People will not follow until they can embrace a vision as their own. They must be able to see exciting possibilities for themselves. To realize a vision, then, leaders have to be clear not only about why it is important to them, but they must be equally clear about why it is important to those they lead. To perform at their best, leaders enlist others in a common vision by appealing to shared ideals and aspirations. When you truly understand and take to heart the hopes and dreams of those you are involved with, you can breathe life into the aspirations of others. You are able to forge a unity of purpose by explaining and showing how and why the dream is for the common good. The way you ignite passion in others is by expressing contagious enthusiasm for the compelling vision of the group, communicating their zeal through vivid language and an expressive style. Challenge the process. Every single personal best leadership case involved some change from the status quo. Not one person claimed to achieve a personal best by keeping things the same, doing what had always been done. They said, "I needed to change the business-as-usual climate by finding ways to experiment and learn." "We began by brainstorming what we would change if anything was possible." And, "We found that big things are done by doing lots of small things." This is why leaders challenge the process. Challenge is the crucible for greatness. It provides the context in which adversity and vision interact to provide for the creation of something new. When at their best, leaders are pioneers. They are willing to step out into the unknown and continuously search for opportunities by seizing the initiative and by looking outward for innovative ways to improve. While they are proactive, leaders aren't the only creators or originators of new programs, services, or processes. In fact, it's more likely that they're not. Innovation comes more from listening than from telling, more from asking questions and hearing what others are thinking and have to say. When challenging the process, your primary contributions are often the recognition of good ideas, the support of those ideas, and the willingness to challenge the system to get new products, processes, services, and systems adopted. We also found that in the personal best leadership experiences, leaders had to experiment and take risks by continually generating small wins and learning from experience. Leaders know well that innovation and change all involve trial and error. One way you can deal with these potential risks and failures is to approach change through incremental steps. Little victories, when piled on top of each other, build confidence that people can meet even the most significant challenges. In making those victories possible, you strengthen commitment to the long-term future. Learning also unlocks the door to progress, and exemplary leaders make a point to ask, "What can we learn when things don't go as expected?" The best leaders are the best learners. Treating every experiment, every innovation, and every mistake as an opportunity to develop and grow. Enable others to act. Leaders know they can't get it done alone. Grand dreams don't become significant realities through the actions of a single person. In their personal best cases, they showed their appreciation of this truth with statements such as, "It was necessary to take into consideration each person's perspectives and ensure that the decisions were made by the team and not individual decisions." The key was building relationships with people who were needed to help us make this happen. And giving them the space and latitude to do their work gave them the confidence to do what hadn't been done before. Leadership is a team effort, not a solo performance. And to make extraordinary things happen in organizations, exemplary leaders enable others to act. Leaders proudly discuss how they had to foster collaboration by building a climate of trust and facilitating relationships. They engage all those who were necessary to make the project work and develop collaborative relationships with colleagues. They are considerate of the needs and interests of others. They bring people together, creating an atmosphere where people understand they have a shared fate and that they should treat others as they would like to be treated. They make sure that everyone wins. This experience underscores how the work of leaders is making people feel strong, capable, and committed. Leaders strengthen others by increasing self-determination and developing competence and confidence. People don't stick around for very long or perform at their best if their leader makes them feel weak, dependent, or alienated. People will give their all when you can strengthen their belief that they can do more than they ever thought possible. In fact, it was not unusual for people to indicate that when working with their best leaders, they gave more than 100% of themselves to the endeavor, because that leader was able to bring out from them more than what they themselves had imagined. When people have confidence in you, and your relationship with them is based on trust, they are most willing to take risks, make changes, and maintain forward momentum. Encourage the heart. The climb to the top of any new and challenging endeavor is arduous and steep, and it is not surprising that people can become exhausted, frustrated, and disenchanted. Leaders indicated in their personal best leadership experiences that they had to encourage the heart of those with whom they were working to carry on, especially when they might have been tempted to give up. They said things such as, "You have to show people that you care about them as people and how they are capable of doing a lot more than they think." Praise and encouragement are the best gifts because people need to have their hard work and efforts acknowledged to know that they are making a difference. And we were generous with compliments, and this allowed us to feel good about ourselves. And when you feel good, you are more productive. Genuine acts of caring, whether exhibited in dramatic gestures or simple actions, uplift people's spirits and keep them motivated. It is part of a leader's job to recognize contributions by showing appreciation for individual excellence. Over the years, we've seen thousands of examples of individual recognition and group celebration from handwritten.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.